Everybody, how's everybody doing this Sunday? Been good? Is everybody doing good this Sunday?
Yeah.
There we go. All right. So on this first song, what we're going to do is if you're a guest today, we'd just like to greet you. We're going to have our ushers come by. They're going to get a connect card in your hand. So with this first verse, as soon as you get a connect card in your hand, go ahead and stand and sing with us and just rejoice in the Lord. Those who are just our normal church members can go ahead and stand with us and sing.
Life born from grace and grace.
out here.
I hear the song, I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song, I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song, I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song, I hear the song of victory ring over me. And you are the God that saves, you are the one that rescues me. You rescue me. You are the God that saves. You are the one that rescues me. You rescue me. You are the God that saves. And you call me from the grave. You rescue me.
Rescued you this Sunday. Say an amen right there. So we came out of, I think it was 2 weeks ago, we had revival. And, you know, he just put such a desire in our hearts. I'm hoping that your heart is still burning from 2 weeks ago. You know, as we're singing these praise and worship songs, we're getting ready for Poem Sunday. But I want you guys just to have in your heart this state of praise and state of thank you all week. And I hope that it burns for all year. Because what God has said in Luke chapter 19, verse 40, he says, and he answered and said unto them, I tell you that if these should not hold, or that if these should hold their peace, so if we hold our peace, the stones would immediately cry out. So can you imagine that today? So when I'm thinking about stones, you know, all the rocks that we walk on, that we toss about or we put in gravel, God could immediately say, you know, they're going to cry out my name if we don't. And that's never what I would like to have in my heart, that God would have to call upon something that we walk on or that we throw about every day, that we use normal, you know, in our everyday life to cry out his name instead of us who he created, who he sent his only son to die for us. So as you prepare your hearts, you know, have a state of worship in your mind. Have a state of worship in your heart. Never let that come to pass that God's going to call upon rocks to call out his name instead of us. So as we sing this next song, just have that in your heart. Thank you. sing this next phrase, just sing it out with everything you've got.
When I see that cross, I see freedom. When I see that grave, I'll see Jesus. And from death to life, I will sing your praise.
Some of these songs that'll just pierce your heart all the time. I love singing about our Lord. I love singing about his praises. So this next song, Glorious Day, just think about that day that Jesus is going to be coming back. He's going to call his children up. He's going to take us to heaven to live with him forever. No more pain, no more suffering, no tears, no crying, no nothing. But he says it's done. So as we sing this next song, just think about it.
Save me, buried, he carried my sin. the trump with his sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glory will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one bringing. My Savior Jesus is mine. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. And rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, glorious day, oh glorious day.
I'm going to have Stacy replay that chorus and ending here in a second, but we were just up here practicing earlier, and Stacy said such a profound thing that, you know, Jesus didn't just die and raise from the dead. When he died, he conquered death. He didn't just say, okay, I'm going to rise from the dead. I'm going to walk out and, you know, save my people and die for their sins. He walked over and put death down. He holds it. He conquered it. He's our Savior. He's the one we're singing about this Sunday. In your heart, just let there be a praise for him. Like I said earlier, don't let the rocks cry out for him. Let you cry out for him. Let your heart be joyous. Sing with love and rapture in your heart. Don't let, you know, 2 weeks ago with our, with the praise that we were doing and the, what was led to our hearts, don't let that pass away this year. Don't let that pass away this week. Don't let it pass away when you go to work. Let it go through you this whole entire year. So as we sing that again, sing it out with all your heart. Close your eyes if you feel like it, and just praise the Lord today.
Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. And rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day. Oh, glorious day.
Lord, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for what you did on the cross. Thank you for conquering death and not just dying and saying it was done, but holding death down. You are the true God. You died for us. You loved us. And Lord, you can call out to the rocks and trees and anything else in this world and say, call unto me, and I want to hear you praise. But Lord, you chose us to praise and worship you and call out to you. Lord, we just thank you for that. And I pray that our hearts would be shaped and they would be molded for this Sunday and for next Sunday and for this whole entire year to come. May we never lose that praise and that desire to worship you. May we never lose that thought that you died for us. Father, we thank you and love you for all you've done and you've yet to do. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated.
Every song must end. but you never do.
You ever been choked up before? Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask the guys, will you put the chorus back up on that song real quick? Man, could you imagine what it would be like to actually be there on the first Palm Sunday? Could you imagine what that would be like? This morning, we're going to be in Luke 19, if you go ahead and turn there. But the emotion that Jesus is experiencing in this chapter is just all over the place, just the emotion of what he's seeing in front of him. As an all-knowing Savior, he knows what's coming, and in fact, in this particular passage, he tells the guys to go get the donkey, and he tells them where it's at, and he says, now send two of you to go get it, because I know it's going to take two of you to get that ornery critter over here, because he's never been rode on before. So go get him, and he sees the future, and he sees what's coming up. He sees the week ahead of him. And I wanted to just see this song, so I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, because all that I have is a hallelujah. Can you say that? Hallelujah. One more time. That's what I have, a hallelujah. The next screen. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king. I have nothing else that I could really bring to you than my praise, my voice, except for a heart singing hallelujah. As Marion and I talked about the service today and the worship today, and I shared with him where I was going to be in Luke chapter 19, and we talked about that particular verse that he was sharing with you earlier. There's just so much in this passage, and I hope this morning in just a few minutes, in about 20, 25 minutes, I can share with you really what I feel is something that we need to take home with us today. A couple thoughts from what Jesus said to his men, but some things that we need to start applying in our life and start doing in our lives as well, or be reminded of to be doing in our life. And at verse 40 in chapter 19, as Marion shared it with us, and he answered and said unto them, talking to the Pharisees, says, I tell you that if these should hold their peace, talking about those that are praising him, if they should stop praising me, that it would go to basically to the stones, and then says, and would immediately cry out. Prophetically, something and someone was going to cry out to the name of Jesus with a hallelujah. Let me hear it one more time. Hallelujah. That there was going to be a hallelujah that was going to ring out, that was going to come from the hearts of someone or something, whether it was creation or us, his creation. And in this passage, we're going to go verse by verse and kind of go through it this morning. So I want to just get us in a place where we see the theme for today, and that is today is the day. And this is one thing that Jesus is just penetrating into the hearts of those that are around him that day, that today is the day. And we're going to see this, especially when we get through verse 41 through 44, where he's addressing not only the Pharisees, but he's addressing the crowd that is there. And he shares with them some very important things. But I want us to, as we start out, to get a couple thoughts in our mind, and that is Jesus has come to be a Savior. Jesus has come to be a Savior. Now, just in practical terms, thinking about a Savior, how many of you know what Jesus did when he was growing up? What was he? A carpenter, or someone may say he was a mason, where he laid rock, and there's probably a lot of discussion there. But basically, he did not come to be a builder. All right? He didn't come to do that. He didn't come to be an electrician. He didn't come to create all these wonderful things for us to enjoy. He didn't come for that. He came because we had a sin problem, and he came to be our Savior. I want us to put in our minds what's happening right before this chapter. Right before this, everybody knows the story of Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus had a wonderful reputation in his community, didn't he? No, he didn't. He had a horrible reputation, right? He represented the tax collectors in a very horrible way. Obviously, I guess that's what they did. They just made their money, right? And he did it in a very dishonest way. He had a terrible testimony in the community. And what does Jesus do? Jesus finds him in the tree, and what does he say? What does he say to him? He's like, Zacchaeus, come on down. I'm going to your house. Let's go hang out. And by doing this, Jesus is associating with someone who is not of good reputation. And in the leadership and the church of that day, or the temple and those religious leaders, they saw Jesus as someone who is tearing down what they were trying to build. And I want us to comprehend that and be reminded of that this morning, that in their minds, he was tearing things down. Here he goes and shows favor to this Zacchaeus. Obviously, Zacchaeus' life was changed, but they didn't see the change. Obviously, this was going to take some time to show the change of what happened in Zacchaeus' life, but the religious leaders were feeling like he was pulling them down. Another thing I want to remind us of this morning is that Jesus is the open door. Jesus is the open door for you to express to others, to open to them. And there's three different types of people that we'll find in the world today that approach this open door. We'll find disbelievers who will not enter that door. We'll find a believer who will enter that door. And we'll find what I'm going to call this morning just an introduction as a misbeliever. Someone who walks through that door but never does anything with their life for God. They never do anything with their life to make a difference for him, to point other people to this open door. Some people have chosen that Jesus would not reign over them. And look at verse 27, would you, of the passage there, Luke 19. We're going to start in verse 28, but I want you to see verse 27. In this verse, some people have chosen that he would not reign over them. They have chosen to reject him, to disbelieve. So because of their choice, they are going to be slain as unbelievers, as it says there. And can you imagine, because of the love of Jesus to mankind, this is a very hurtful type of phrase to say, you're going to be slain. But I want you to realize that Jesus always had to share the honest truth. He had to give the full truth and say, if you do not choose me, if you do not come through this open door, that you will be slain, that you will not be with me in eternity. And I can just hear the heartbeat of Jesus as he's like, I don't want to have to say this, but I have to say it. I have to tell you what the truth is. I want us to realize that he came to be our Savior. Look at chapter 19, and we'll start in verse 28. And when he had thus spoken, speaking obviously of Jesus, he went before, ascending up to Jerusalem. I love the word that he uses there, to ascend up, because this is not in reference to Revelations where he's going to descend, but he's getting ready to ascend, if you will, to the cross. Verse 29. And it came to pass, when he was come nigh to Bethphage and to Bethany, at the mount called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples. So here's where he sees and he knows the prophecy that's to come. He knows what's happening. And I want to remind us, all of these chapters before, what were the people wanting him to do? They wanted him to be what? King, right? Everybody remember that? How they're pushing Jesus to be king. Hey, we want you to be king. And he always refused them and always slipped away and was always trying to get out of that situation of them making him a king. But now you see him embracing that. And he actually sends the disciples. Look at it as it says. It says he sends the two and he says to them, go ye to the village over against you, in which at your entering you shall find the colt tied, whereupon yet never man sat. Loose him and bring him hither. When we read this, a couple of thoughts come to mind. One, I want us to see a picture on the screen right now of what it looked like for them. They're on the Mount of Olives. They stop here, and they're looking to Jerusalem. If you guys could pop that up there. This is obviously the current view of what's there, but this is them looking down, all right, from the Mount of Olives, looking at Jerusalem. And when they go to find the colt. I love how Jesus makes things convenient. Where did it say in the scripture that they'd find the colt? Look at it. Where did it say? Where at? Towards the entrance, right? He made it real. He didn't make them have to go through all these little different canals and different places in the city to go down to this certain spot and find this colt. He made it real simple. I love it when Jesus makes things simple. You like that? Say amen. I like it when he makes things simple, because I'm that kind of guy. I need it simple, right? So he says to go down, it's going to be close to the entrance, this is going to be convenient for you. And I can imagine the conversation. Can you just be one of those two disciples this morning for a minute? And you're on your way, and he tells them specifically the detail to find the donkey or the colt that is tied that never a man has sat on. And if you know anything about donkeys, what's their temperament like? A little bit stubborn, aren't they? And can you imagine on the way they're going, okay, am I going to lead them or are you going to lead them? No, you're going to lead them, I ain't leading them. I'm just going to talk to him. You lead him. You pull him. I ain't pulling him. I don't know what the discussion was like, because they knew they were up to something that was not going to be the easiest thing, a stubborn donkey. And I want to just remind us for a minute that if God and Jesus, obviously in the story, if Jesus could use a stubborn donkey, all right, to fulfill prophecy and use him in his life, I think God can get over our stubbornness. Don't you think God can soften us a little bit? And he softens obviously the personality normally of a donkey. We can see, I don't know what that trip was like coming back, but I can only imagine that conversation. But when the donkey gets to Jesus, we'll see what happens here in a minute. Verse 31. And he also gives them another detail. He says, and if any man ask you, why do you loose him? Thus shall you say unto him, because the Lord hath need of him. Can you say that phrase with me? The Lord hath need of him. And in verse 32 and 33, we go on to see that this is actually how it unfolds. They actually come to the owner in verse 33. He asks, why loose ye the colt? And I wonder what's going through his mind. Maybe he's glad to get rid of this donkey. I don't know. But needless to say, the donkey is taken because he tells him exactly what to say, 34. And he responds to the owner and says, the Lord hath need of him. Say it with me again. The Lord hath need of him. When we process that phrase, the Lord hath need of him, what does the Lord hath need in you today? How does God want to use you? How does God want to use you with Easter weekend and this reach out, this, you know, this outreach to our church community, our church and our community together, this egg drop? How does God want to use you in that? How does God want to use you in a normally weekly process of his kingdom, of opening the door of Jesus to other people? How does God want to use me in that? That's the question I want you to ask yourself this morning. God, how do you want to use me? You're going to use this donkey for a specific reason. You're going to use him because he's needed. How am I needed, God? What do I need to be doing? In verse 35, when they brought him to Jesus and they cast their garments upon the colt. Notice the detail of them taking their garments to place on the colt. They sat Jesus thereupon. And as he went, they spread their clothes in the way. Now, something that you have to kind of grab a hold of here a little bit that we don't know from exactly what the scripture is saying. Normally, this region was holding about 600,000 people, but because of the feast and what's happening, there's 2 to 3 million people. And when we process what this is saying, when he said they spread their clothes in the way, there's not just Jesus and the disciples up on the mount. It's just not them. I want to show this next picture, and this is coming from Jerusalem up to the Mount of Olives. And you can see the golden tip there. Obviously, that wasn't there in that day, but all the greenery right behind that, that's the Mount of Olives. And as Jesus is getting ready to make his way to Jerusalem, there's a lot of things I know that as we think, what could be going through his mind right now? When the people are getting ready to show this worship, to show this display, in verse 37, look at it, it says, and when he was come nigh, even now at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to rejoice and to praise God with what? With a loud voice. For all the mighty works that they had seen. The next verse says what they were seeing. It says, and they were saying, blessed be the King who cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Can you say that with me? It's on the screen, I think. They'll put it up for us. Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. How many of you have like a jacket or something this morning? Just kind of hold it up. Let me see your jacket or sweater if you got one. You got one? All right, you got it. Some of you got it on. Kind of cold this morning. All right. Can you just imagine with me for just a minute that they were taking off maybe that outer lament because they didn't want him to walk on the dirt and the whatever, the gravel, whatever was there. And they were laying their clothes out before him. And John, it says they were taking palm branches if they didn't have that extra garment to lay out before him. Can you just imagine them? Maybe even waving it before he gets there and laying it before him. And saying those phrases and then singing out with a loud voice. You guys put that back on the screen for me. That verse, blessed. Blessed is the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Can you say it with me again? Blessed be the King that cometh. Let's just say that first phrase. I want you to get this phrase in your head, all right? And the only way to do that sometimes is to repeat it and to say it out loud. Blessed be the King that cometh. Say it again with me. Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord. One more time. Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord. Now what I want you to do is I want you to put your hands on each side of your face like this. Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord. Louder. Blessed be the King. I'm watching you up there, Keith. Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord. Louder. Blessed be the King that cometh and the name of the Lord. Louder. Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord. Could you imagine what that was like? Could you imagine what that was like to see the King, the one who had done all these miracles? Can you imagine the crowd? Who's in that crowd? The people who had been healed. The people who had seen things happening in their life and their family. Could it be the man who brought his son or came to Jesus and said, hey, my son's back home. Can you come with me? He says, no, I'm gonna heal him from right here. Go back home. He's healed. Who was in that crowd? Blessed be the King who cometh in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. I can only imagine what it was truly like to make that day the day that it was. Today is the day. What is today like for you? What is the level of your worship in your heart today? Would you even be attending that time where this is happening? If someone told you, hey, we heard Jesus is up on the Mount of Olives. Let's go up and check out what he's going to do. You know he's going to do something. Let's go check it out. And would you be going? Would you be there? Would you be inspired? Would you be moved to start singing and say, blessed be the King who cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven, glory in the highest. Would you be saying that? Would you be screaming that? Would you with a loud voice be proclaiming that? Would I be doing that? Would I take the clothes that I had as a garment to lay before him in honor? As you notice the detail that they put a garment also on the colt. The disciples started this whole thing privately by doing the same thing. They were doing this out of this honor and out of this praise to him. It wasn't because, oh, you got to saddle the donkey. No, I believe it was from their heart that they did this. I can only imagine what it was like that day to be there. And then the Pharisees are obviously in the crowd also. Look at verse 39. It says, some of the Pharisees from among the multitude said unto him, Master, rebuke thy disciples. This is blasphemy. This is untrue. You need to tell them to stop screaming this and shouting this. Could you only imagine the competition that was going on in the Pharisees' mind of, I can't believe Jesus is stealing the show right now. He's not allowed to do this. This is untrue. And of course, they didn't believe Jesus was the Messiah. And Jesus responds to them, as we already read in verse 40. Look at it again. I tell you that if these should hold their peace, those that were shouting out, blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, he says the stones would immediately cry out. And look at verse 41. And when Jesus was come near, he's coming nearer and nearer as he's coming and making his way to Jerusalem, ascending to Jerusalem, he beheld the city, and it says he wept over it. Now, when you study the word wept, it means to, you could say, convulsing. This wasn't like, oh, a little tear coming from the corner of his eye. Oh, I'm so sad. No, he was convulsing and weeping over the city and weeping over the people. Because he knew what was happening for him, but he knew also what was about to happen to Jerusalem not too much further down the road, and he's going to proclaim that in just a couple verses. But when he beheld the city, he wept over it. Can I just ask myself and you this morning, what vision do we have for our city? What is my vision for our Jerusalem? Do I weep over those who do not know who he is? Do I proclaim him in these ways of blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord? Do I easily say that to those who don't even know him to try to cause this open door to happen? God has open doors for us. God has need of us. He wants to use us, but how will he use us? Will I be sharing? Will I be weeping over my city? Will I be moved in my heart that they're lost? And I need to do more about it. Verse 42, Jesus says, if thou hast known, even thou, at least in this thy day, The things which belong unto thy peace, you could have peace if you knew what this day was really all about. But now they are hid from thine eyes. There's a lot of truth that's coming out of this verse. One of them is he's saying to them, today is a day that you're very unaware of what's really happening. Today is the day. The prophet Isaiah or Zechariah and also Daniel proclaimed this day in prophecy. Psalms 118:24 says, this is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice. And what's the rest of it? And be glad in it. This is in reference to this situation, this day that's happening right now. In Daniel chapter 9 and then also in Jeremiah, a lot of prophecy leading up to this. It was said, from the command of the rebuilding of Jerusalem until Messiah coming into Jerusalem would be 483 years. Daniel seeks God and God gives him this prophecy. So if you times 483 years times 360 days per year, you come up with 173,880 days is when this day is happening, and the Pharisees didn't know what was happening. They had the prophecy, they had the instruction, but they didn't know what was happening, and Jesus is saying, guys, you're missing it. Church leadership, you're missing it. Church, you're missing it. Don't you realize what's going on? Obviously, there was people that were there that didn't know what was going on, but some that didn't know what was going on, and then some that were just experiencing it, and they would find out later what was going on. But I want us to see the whole thing that Jesus is trying to get at with the Pharisees is to tell them that you have forfeited your peace because you don't know what today represents. Look at 43, 44. This is much of the reason why Jesus is not only looking to the cross, but looking at Jerusalem and what's going to happen. It says, for the days shall come upon thee that thine enemies, the Romans, shall cast a trench about thee and compass thee round and keep in every side and shall lay thee even with the ground and thy children within thee. And they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another. They're going to just tear the city apart. Because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. I want to know when God is visiting me. I know your desire is to know when God is visiting you. We don't want to miss that visitation. The Pharisees were missing it. The peace could have been theirs, but it was not theirs. In verse 43 and 44, the real message that's coming across from Jesus is to be aware. To be aware of what's happening around you. In Mark chapter 11, verse 11, and when we look at even into 45, it says, And he went into the temple and began to cast out them that sold therein and them that bought. There's a whole nother situation beginning now as he actually enters into the temple. And Mark chapter 11, verse 11 says that he didn't actually, this is left out in Luke, that's why we have all four Gospels to get all of these details. But in Mark chapter 11, it says that he went and stayed the night and came back the next morning, and that's when this began to happen. But it does say that he saw the temple and saw what was going on, and it troubled him, and he left that night, went to sleep there at his location, then came back the next morning. And when he got there, this is when all the tables started turning over. And you know, I didn't really understand all that was happening until I started studying it a little bit. And you've got the priest, you've got money exchangers, the bank, if you will, and then you've got those who provide sacrifice animals there. All right, so three things. I want you to see this. So you have those that are providing sacrifices because people are traveling a long way. Everybody say a long way. They're coming a long way, and they don't want to carry and bring them animals that far. So they, when they get to the temple, that's when they're going to get their animal instead of bringing their animal. Then you have the money exchange because you live a long way over there. Your money's different than ours, so we got to exchange the money, and then then you can take that money, temple shekels, and you can go buy what you want to buy. But the priest was the one who would look at the sacrifice and go, it's okay, or no, it's not okay. So you got these three entities that are working against the people. And Jesus sees this, and he's just tore up about it. He's tore up about what his house has become. because of all this dishonor. It wasn't a bad thing that they were trying to provide sacrifices. That wasn't the bad thing. The bad thing was that if they came to the priest was in dealings with these other guys. He said, no, your sacrifice is not good enough. You need to go get you a different one. So that one's no good. What are we going to do with him? I don't know, but we'll find another one. So we got to go buy another sacrifice. But when I exchange my money, I'm getting gypped because now I've got, I just lost 10%, 15%, whatever it was. But can you imagine how that Jesus is tore up about this? In the it would be called the Court of Galilee in the temple, that there was tons of room there. Maybe 1,000 feet by 1,000 feet, 60,000 people would be held easily in there. But we know because of this current situation of the feast and all that's going on, that there's 2 to 3 million people, and I can only imagine what it was like, again, coming off the Mount of Olives, coming into Jerusalem, and then this is what he finds. Could you imagine the high for Jesus? Go with me for a minute. Could you imagine the emotional high of them crying out, blessed be the King? And then he gets to the temple and he sees the condition of the temple. But I want to remind you also in John chapter 2, he had already dealt with this a couple years earlier. If you look at it, John chapter 2, he dealt with this once. So it's not the first time Jesus has dealt with this. So he comes back this time and it's back to the same thing. I don't know about you, but if anyone has misrepresented you before, whether you tell someone something at work and they're supposed to relay it and they don't relay it in the right way and you're misrepresented. Everybody say that, misrepresented. Say it one more time, Have you ever been misrepresented? Or someone tells a story not quite how it was and you've been misrepresented in that situation? Jesus is so upset because his house is being misrepresented. Could you imagine, again, all these people coming from a long, long way. Could you imagine someone being so excited to get there because they've never got to come to this location for this situation or for this celebration. And so they're coming and they get there and they find all this craziness going on. Could you imagine the misrepresentation that they felt when that it wasn't what they thought they were going to find? I want us to be so careful that we represent Jesus Christ the way we need to and the way that I need to. Misrepresentation causes eternal consequences. So today, as we think about today being the day, the Pharisees missing what day this really was, we're going to finish with these last couple of verses, and I have a couple of thoughts for as we close. And as he taught daily in the temple, but the chief priests and the scribes and the chiefs of the people sought to destroy him. This is obviously something we need to be very careful of, that we don't destroy anything that has to do with Jesus Christ or his house. And it says in verse 48, and could not find what they might do. They didn't have a way to get to him because for all the people were very attentive to hear him. I love how God uses his son, Jesus, to clarify what his house is for. And I want to remind our church this morning that this is not a place just to have, you know, so everybody can see. But this is an altar that's been given for our church to come and to seek the Lord. That's what it's for. Everybody say, that's what the altar's for. It's for a prayer. That's what it's for. And I don't want us to not take advantage of the altar. I know sometimes we'll have people come by the church and they come through the office and they just come in here to pray. And that's making good use of the altar. I want to encourage us as a church family, even Balcony, and I know we're all trying to be very careful of COVID, but I'm going to say that maybe you need to make an altar up there. If it's uncomfortable to come to this altar, that you would kneel and pray where you're seated. That we would not be this person who is like this Pharisee that doesn't see what's really happening. And we'll ask God, God, what are you saying to me today? How do I need to respond? And I love the clarity that Jesus gives in 46 as he says, my house is a house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. A couple thoughts and we'll be done. First thing is this. Jesus will give you instructions. I want us to realize this morning that not only in these guys' lives and these ladies' lives did God give instruction, but Jesus will give you instruction. Jesus will give you a partner. You know, in my life, I've had a lot of people who have helped me in a lot of different ways. But there's a partnership in the church that just cannot be touched by anything else. The brothers that we share life with, the sisters that our ladies share life with, He will give us a partner. Jesus will give us good reasons. Or Jesus will give you reasons of why you need to do what you do. Or why you're doing what you're doing. Hey, this is why I want you to do this. A good reason of why I'm doing this. I want you to notice also in those earlier verses, Jesus gave them words. Jesus will give you words to say. You say, Matt, I don't know what to say. How do I say it? You don't have to think about it. Just say it. Just ask God, God, put the words in my mouth. He gave the guys the clear words to say if they were to be questioned. And then I want you to realize that Jesus will give you a song. And I want to just stop here for a minute. Some of us lose our song. How many of you have been there before? I have. Raise your hand. You've been there before. You just lost a song. And you just, what I mean by that is you're kind of going through a hard time where it's just hard to worship. And in those moments, it's even more important that you worship. Jesus gave them a song. Jesus will give us a song. Jesus will show you His glory. When you get to that place where you're meeting with Him, He will show you His glory, just as they experienced it. Jesus will weep over you. There's so much in our hearts and our lives that we need to be a little more serious about. And that's our city of Hillsboro. The surrounding cities, how serious are we about reaching into their lives? So these are things that Jesus will do, and then there's some things that I want us to remind us of that we need to do. We must pay attention. Obviously, the Pharisees were not doing a very good job of this, but we need to be paying attention. Everybody tell your neighbor, pay attention. He's almost done. Pay attention. In your life, are you paying attention to what's going around you, what's happening around you? Are you attentive? Gentlemen, are you attentive to what you need to be doing for your wife? Wives, are you attentive to your husband? Parents, are you attentive to your kids? At your job, are you attentive to what your boss needs? Are you attentive to what's going on around you? Are you asking the Spirit of God to lead you through all these little places and spots in your life? And one more thing, a couple more things. I must remember I am expensive. What do I mean by that? I want you to realize that Jesus paid an awful lot for you. You're expensive. Not only you are expensive, but there's a lot of people in our community who don't realize how expensive they are. They've never been able to take advantage of what Jesus has done for them yet. So this upcoming Easter weekend, let's be a part of sharing that. Let's be a part of sharing how important they are to our Savior. I must represent Him. In my life, I must represent Him well. The Bible says that my body is a temple. And we're talking about the temple in Jerusalem, but the Bible says that you in the New Testament, that your body is a temple. How is my temple representing Him? What needs to change in me? And then I must respond to the King. Or you could say, I need to respond to my Lord. I love the older, you know, shows that you can watch different things, and they have these wonderful accents, right? And they always say, I'm here, my Lord. What can I do for you, my Lord? Right? They're always asking, they always end it with, my Lord. Everybody say, my Lord. Say it with an accent, my Lord. My Lord. Yeah, right? And so I want you to go to God this morning, and I want to say, I'm here, my Lord. What do you have for me to change today? What step do I need to, am I being a little bit like these Pharisees? Am I not realizing what's going on around me? And one last thing I want to share with you this morning is that God desires a response. Every time that we have His Word input to our life, whether it's in a Bible fellowship class or whether it's in your personal devotions, God desires and deserves a response from us. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes just for a minute? Take a private moment. I'm going to ask Stace to come, and I'm going to ask Marion also to come this morning, if you would. We're going to have just a moment like we always do, a time where we can respond. If you say, Matt, I'm uncomfortable with just kind of what's going on in our culture right now to kind of go up to the altar, then I want you to make an altar right at your seat. I know some, because of health, you cannot turn and kneel in your seat, and I understand that. But I want you to realize how expensive you are and who your King is this morning. That we would bow in response to Him and say, God, my Lord, here's some things that I heard from the Scripture this morning. It might be something totally off of what I said, but the Spirit of God spoke to you about something, and you need to respond to Him about that. Would you respond this morning about that? Would you tell Him about it? Maybe today you don't know for sure that you're going to go to heaven. You don't know that for sure. And today is your day to make that step in your life. This would be a wonderful day to make that choice in your heart, to choose Christ today. I want to just ask that question just for a minute this morning. If you say, Matt, I'm not sure that I'm going to spend an eternity in heaven. I don't know if I've ever really specifically asked Jesus to be my Savior. I know He died for me. I know He rose for me. But I've never asked Him to be my personal Savior. I've never made that prayer. And I have questions about what I would need to do. And I want to know what the Scripture says about that. I said, Matt, I just have questions. Can you just slip your hand up and say, Matt, I just want you to know this morning I've got questions. I'm thinking about this. It's something that's bothering me. I know that I'm not going to go to heaven because I've never made that. I've never made that choice, but I have questions. Is there someone that would say, Matt, that's me this morning. Would you just slip your hand up and back down? And say, Matt, pray for me. Anybody like that? Say, Matt, pray for me. I don't know that I'm going to be in heaven when my life's done. I'm going to make a prayer, and I'm going to ask Marion to start the song, and I'm going to just ask that if God has spoken to you and you want to come to the altar, I'm going to ask you not to wait until I'm done with my prayer. I'm going to ask you to come as soon as I start to pray. Whatever response you need to make to Him this morning, I'm going to ask you to make it as soon as I start my prayer. I want you to slip out, not to wait. You say, Matt, I need to pray. I need to share some things with the Lord this morning. Then you do that at your seat if you're not comfortable coming to the front. But I'm going to ask you to make the altar what it was used for and what it's designed for. So I'm getting ready to pray. And as soon as I begin, I want you to slip out if that's you this morning. If you say, Matt, I do have questions about my eternity. I don't know if I've ever made that request to Jesus to be my Savior. Then this morning, I want you to come. And I want to meet you here in the front, and I want to have someone be able to share that with you. So if God has spoken to you about responding to Him, I'm going to ask you to do that as soon as I begin my prayer. Lord, I thank You for the day. God, I pray that we would not forget how important this day was, that very first day that it happened on Palm Sunday. God, when You were coming down to and ascending to, I guess I should say, to Jerusalem. And God, You saw all in front of You, the week that was ahead of You, and how difficult that week would be. But God, how that Your people were praising You for being blessed be the King. And Lord, I pray that this morning that we would respond, that we will realize that, God, that You have words for us to share. God, You have a song for us to sing. God, You have things for us to pay attention to. God, help us not to miss what those things are. So God, may we speak to You this morning and respond to You. We ask all this in Your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing. Marion, lead us.
Joy, could You see beyond the grave?
soul were dying for.
Sing it out.
How wonderful, how glorious, my Savior's scars, victorious. My chains are gone, my debt is paid, from death to life, and grace to grace.
Would you bow your heads for just a moment in an attitude of prayer? Right now, I'm going to specifically ask our church family to pray for our city. The Bible says that when Jesus came near, he beheld the city and he wept over it. I'm going to just ask you, God, would you bless this upcoming weekend? God, would you allow us to reach into the lives of families who do not know you and to invite them to an event for fun and an excitement of Easter, but God, that we would be able to point them to you on Saturday. Would you just pray over that right now? Would you just take a minute right now? Would you do that? If you're praying for that, just slip your hand up so I know you're praying for it. Right now, pray for it. Say, God, would you do a work in our city? Would you do a work with Saturday? Would you do a work with Sunday? But God, we would see people come to know you as Savior. I'm going to ask Mary just to sing through that chorus. I'm going to ask you to stay in an attitude of prayer. Maybe there's someone that you would pray for, maybe a neighbor, a coworker, someone that you're trying to reach. And maybe if you say, you know, Matt, I don't have a name this morning, but I'm going to pray for God to bring someone into my life this week, someone brand new I've never met before, that I could invite them to Saturday and Sunday, and that I would see God do something in their life. So Marion, sing that for us. I want you to pray over that right now, if you would, church family. As he sings, you pray.
Savior scars, victorious. My chains are gone, my debt is paid, from death to life, and grace to grace.
Amen. What a great Palm Sunday, amen. Great way to start the events that will lead to the kingdom being built and starting totally different way than we've ever seen a kingdom built before, not with sword or violence or war, but a kingdom that's built with sacrifice and the death of a king. But it doesn't end that way. Come back next week. You're going to find out. Easter's coming. We are excited for it. I just want to say this. You guys can be seated real quick. We're going to pray here and ask God to bless our offering here in a moment, but I just want to start out by just saying this. If you're brand new here at Hillsboro Bible, we love you. Thank you for joining us today. We're going to ask you to do something. We're going to ask you not to give today. We want to make sure that if this is your first time here, we want to make sure that you know exactly what that's about, that we give out of our hearts, not out of our sustenance or our substance or anything like that. We give from our hearts, and we're just going to ask you this. There's a Connect card that you probably have in the seat in front of you, or there's some one that maybe someone handed you today. We're just going to ask you to fill that out. Give us some information, and we're going to send something to your house, and we have a gift for you actually at the back of the room here too. We want you to get that before you leave here and just drop that card off there. And just by giving us some information, we're just going to share some love with you and just give you some stuff. And so thank you for being here. We love having you. Please fill that out and just leave it there at that back table for us, or drop it off the Welcome Center, and they'll help you out there. But thank you for being here. Today, as we've been doing for a long time now, as you go out, your offering is going to be at the door. So just if you have a tithe or offering, just drop it off to one of our ushers at the door on your way out, and they'll take that for you, make sure that gets placed for you there. I want to pray for us real quick, bless that offering, and then have a few announcements, and then we'll finish up for today. Let's pray and bless that offering. Heavenly Father, we give you all the praise, honor, and glory for everything that was done today. Your word was spoke. Thank you, Lord, for Matt and his just willingness to just give us your scripture and your word without any kind of thought of holding anything back. That's what we need, and we just love that. We thank you, Lord, for it. Bless this offering, bless the cheerful giver, bless the use of it for our community, that your message could be spread, your kingdom could be grown in this area. We love you and thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Just a couple of things real quick. Of course, our big community event is this next Saturday, all right? And so Easter egg drop is coming. They're going to play a video for you, and this is just going to be in the background. I'm just going to explain this for you, all right? Help register, or I'm going to help watch the kids on the inflatables, make sure they don't break their necks and stuff like that. You know, that stuff we need you for, okay? Otherwise, we got kids with a bunch of broken necks. Do you want that? No, right? So volunteer is basically what I'm trying to say. And so go to the Welcome Center, volunteer for that. We're still taking in candy as well. If you see the display out there, we still want to make sure we have plenty of candy for everyone. So please be part of that. Grab some candy this week. Drop it off before that event. We'll make sure and get it where it needs to go. But egg drop is going to be huge, so you want to be here for that. Your Easter Sunday schedule is this. If you see it on the screen here, it's going to be breakfast at 9:15. We're going to have our regular services at 10:40. And then Easter Sunday night, we have a special communion service. So please be here for that. We love taking communion with our church family. Amen. We want to be here and just observe that together. And just sort of inspect our lives together, all right? And so pray and be just worship together on that communion night and observe that together. And then the last things is this. C4 and Forge are doing an event this Wednesday called Egg Stream Game Night. And so if you have a student from 6th grade to 12th grade, bring them out this Wednesday at 7 o'clock. And we're going to have an amazing time with them and just share the message with them. And then we're going to have a glow-in-the-dark egg hunt, all right? And it's going to be, there's cash prizes, okay, kids? So get your friends out. And so we want to be here for that. And then the last one is this. Our security team is getting together right after this service, after we dismiss for a potluck and just sort of a meeting, get together and get things straightened out for security. So if you're part of that, don't miss that. Be over there for that as soon as we're done here. Let's clap it up, all right? Let's give a hand for God's word today. Amen? Amen? Get out this week. Invite somebody to Easter. Do not miss this opportunity. We'll see you back here next week, all right? Have a great day and have a great afternoon.
I can't count the times I've called your name from broken night. And you showed up and patched me up like every time I get amnesia, I forget that you keep coming around. Yeah, ain't no way you ever let me down. Good God Almighty, I hope you find me praising your name no matter what comes. Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is he good?
He's good.
Tell me, is he God?
He's God.
He is
good God Almighty.
You say your love goes on forever, that your mercy never stops. So why would I assume you'll be somebody that you're not?
Praising your name no matter
in the morning, praise him in the noontime, praise him when the sun goes down. Love him in the morning, love him in the noontime, love him when the sun goes down.